really got worried what is happening. Anyways, hello and good evening, everyone. I hope you all are having a great day. I'm sorry for the inconvenience caused right now. As Dr. Vinay sir introduced about me, and as he said that I'll be talking about Assam, which is a very common misconception happens usually every time I say that I'm going to speak on Northeast. Actually, I'm going to talk about the Mizoram, moreover specifically on the Wangchia, and I hope this will help in revealing the history of Mizoram. It might help in rewriting the history of Mizoram. So before starting my presentation, I would also like to thank the Indology Foundation for providing us this platform. And my topic is Wangchia, an insight to history of Mizoram. Wangchia is in almost on border of India and Myanmar. It's in Champai district. As you can see, this is a Google satellite image of the Wangchia village. The population according to 2011 census was 837. Hopefully by 2021, in the upcoming year, next year, the population will be around 2000. The village is very, very isolated, and it is also disconnected for almost 6 months from the rest of the world. Recently, the internet service was provided there in 2015 or 16. I am telling this just to give an idea that how isolated and far away from the normal civilization or our civilization, this new civilization has been found by the P. Rohingan Thanga. Before starting this place is also some 250 kilometers away from the capital city of Mizoram, that is Aizawl. And to reach this place, it took us 2 days just to cover 250 kilometers, which we usually cover in mainland in 2 to 3 hours. Sorry. Before moving on, I would like to start with some basic questions, that who, how, when, and what. Who are the Mizos? How did the settlement of Mizoram started? When did they came here first? What is the history of the Mizo people? What are their cultural, traditional, and moreover historical background? What are the folklores and legends have to say about the Mizoram? And how did Mizoram become a different state? So the history of the Mizoram is started in mystery, just like any other tribe of northeastern India. They generally are accepted theory. There are two generally accepted theory. One is basically that they are part of the great wave of Mongoloid that migrated from China, and later they settled in India at the respective present habitational places of them. It is also possible that Mizos came from Shenlong or Qinglong Sa, located on the bank of the river Yalong in China. They settled in the Shan state and moved on to Kaba Valley of Comfort and then to the Chin Hills in the middle of the 16th century. What are the facts and legends about the Mizo people? The folklores have a totally different and interesting tale to offer, that Mizo people emerged from the large covering rock known as Qinglong. Two people from the Ralte clan came out and started making loud noises and all, and their god got really pissed at them and said in disgust that enough is enough, and asked them, and he felt too many people had already been allowed to step out, so he closed the door with the rock. History often varies from legends, but the stories of Mizo getting out in the open from the netherworld through a rock opening is now part of the Mizo fable. Qinglong, however, is taken by some as the Chinese city of Shenlong or Qinglong Sa. Situated close on the Sino-Burmese border, the Mizos have songs and stories about the glory of the ancient Qinglong civilization, handed down from one generation to another powerful generation. During British era, this era is really important to understand what happened in the history of Mizoram. In 1840s, British people reached the Mizoram region, and before that, Mizoram was under the Assam. It was under the Assam, and was known as Lushai Hills District of Assam. Later, in 1954, it was renamed as Mizo Hills District. In 1895, British India people banned several native cultural practices of Mizo people, such as hunting head. Later, Aizawl was made as a headquarter. And at the time of the British conquest, there were around 60 chiefs. But in around first half of the 20th century, the Christian missionaries arrived, and the majority of the population became Christians. Even right now, according to the census of India, 87% to 88% population of Mizoram is Christian, followed by Hinduism and Buddhism, and so on. Moving to the tribes. What are the tribes? How many tribes are in Mizoram? There are major 5 tribes, and there are 11 minor tribes, known as the common name with Ausia. We need to also understand that Mizo is generally presumed that it defines all of the tribes, but Mizo means the people who are living on the hills or the highlanders. Coming to the Wangchia tribe, as in this presentation I have talked about already Wangchia village. Now I'm talking about Wangchia tribe, and later I'll be talking about the archaeological site Wangchia. These three Wangchia things belong to three different periods. Wangchia village is the present condition, present village of the Mizoram. Wangchia tribe was the native of this Wangchia village. They are also genealogically related to other clans. They trace their descendant from the Chultang, and the Chultang had a son, and he had a dream, and he kept the son under the tree called Wang, and thus he named his son Wang, and that is how the descendant of Wang, Wangchia, the name came, and the descendant of Wangchia are the Wangchia tribe. So Wangchia tribe, when I did the survey there, I got to know that the Wangchia tribe is not presently living in the Wangchia village. They have moved long back, and these people don't associate themselves with the Wangchia tribe. In fact, they associate themselves with the Christianity. Moving on to the Wangchia archaeological site. How the Wangchia archaeological site was found? P. Roming Thanga, the convener of intact Mizoram chapter, during his hunt in 2010 for the heritage sites in Mizoram, came across many of Wangchia. He accordingly informed intact and ASI and government about the menhirs in Wangchia, and it is a huge discovery by him. ASI Director General Rakesh Tiwari in 2011 prepared a proposal draft for exploration and excavation at Wangchia, and in 2015 of November, a team of ASI archaeologists and intact explored the remote villages of Mizoram, and thus further, the need for having an ASI circle for Aizawl, which covers 3 states now, has been established in 2017. Dr. Sujit Nayan sir, who was the head of Aizawl circle, even told Northeast Life in early 2017 that we are still exploring what lay beneath the bushes and thick foliage of the forest. It was amazing to think that this site could hold traces of lost city or even a great lost civilization, which is why we need more time and research to reach a final conclusion. At the early stage of the exploration and excavation, Dr. Sujit Nayan sir also said that this site can be a potential necropolis city. But as the exploration and excavation happened in last 2-3 years, we see the image is changing of the place. So I'll start with the site. I hope you all can see a very good image of, I'll try to explain from this only. So on the left side, this is the Wangchia village. On the southern side of the Wangchia village, from here, we find certain stone structures. And somewhere in middle here, there are different terraces, 9 to 11 terraces covering this whole area on which we have found the whole civilization or the archaeological findings. Somewhere here, then in this blue region, we have found several water pavilions. And when we move towards number 3 and 4, is connected by a very kacha road, is the Menhis, a complex of Menhis. There are around 210 Menhis there, and there's a cave. And then further journey of us will start, where I'll take you to the two other watchtowers, potential watchtowers, kind of structures, and staircases have been found, and how the quarry site was found. Moving on to the what kind of structures we see. They are usually partially dressed stone structures. They were covered in the jungle grasses and the mud, but after cleaning, this is what we have found. These are were named as twin burial, and the excavation is still is need to be done. Moving on to structure 2, in this image you can see on the right side, here is the structure 2, and this is on terrace 2. Structure 1 was on terrace 1. So there is a pathway, there's a huge pathway. Then there here is a retaining wall supporting terrace 3, because this whole site is on Himalayan tail and it is made of sedimentary rocks. So the possibilities and the this happening like natural disasters such as a landslide has very much chances of happening landslides. So you can see there is a structure 2, there is a heap of yellow clay, there is structure 3, there is terrace 3, it supported by retaining wall, there is a 3-meter pathway, and the same kind of pattern we'll see on different terraces also. I'll be showing in the moving slides. Now when we see structure 3, I'll give a different point of view of structure 2 also. You can see it's a big rectangular kind of structure. There are rubble stones, they are divided, and looks like they are divided in different rooms also. Moving on to the kind of clay yellow heap that we see almost near every stone structure. So regarding this, I have a theory that this can be the potential burial ground. As in Mizoram, there are 2 to 3 kind of burial practices. One is in this picture, where I'll show you, this is a picture in the village. We found this inside the village. This is a someone's house, and right outside there, this is a burial. They have covered it with a stone cap, and later when the stone cap was removed, we found a burial inside, just right outside their house. So it is very much possible that if these structures were some household units or a building unit, they can be a potential burial ground. Moving on to structure 4, we see a similar pattern again. On terrace 3, there is a structure 4, there is a retaining wall, then there is a terrace 4 with a structure 5, and there is pathway. For structure 5, you'll see 3 different terraces. It's very much clear here. There's a perennial stream. I like to explain this area as our most probably like a habitational area. Why? Because just imagine, it's a very, the head, the monsoon is for almost 6 months, and it's so heavy that it can cut the city, the village, from the rest of the world for the 6 months. The soil is very sedimentary. It's very loose. The chances of landslides or earthquake is high here. So on any, when we see from the architecture point of view of any hilly region, architecture, we'll see that they usually make a plinth, and on top of that they use perishable materials, locally available perishable materials, which are basically generally wood, and they build their home accordingly. So what I believe is that this can be a possible plinth area which they have created, and for the slides I'll give a top view of the what kind of top view of the structure also. You can see a 2 to 3 steps only. It's not in much. It's just 2 to 3 steps, as if it is allowing to go inside the building or the structure. Can be a possible household unit also. The same age here you can see from terrace 3, if you see towards the structure 5, a clear view of retaining wall is there. It has been damaged because of the natural disasters such as landslide. Moving on to the structure 30, when we discovered structure 30, we also found 9-step staircases, which shows that to go from one terrace to another terrace, they made staircases so that the people can easily commute. So I think they had a pretty good idea of the planning or the architectural point of view. They had a pretty good idea and they kind of established themselves there. And here also we see a retaining wall. The terrace, structure 13, the same pattern continues. Another view for structure 14. For structure 14, we also again see there is a staircase for connecting one terrace to another terrace. And then here are also 2 steps for the structure 14. Moving on to structure 14C. And okay, for structure 17, I'd like to tell here. So, while I asked the local villagers that if they know anything about the site or they have came here and saw anything or not, so they told me that on all these structures, there were huge stone slabs. For example, you can see one here. All these stone slabs are now used in this village by villagers for their Christian burial grounds. Later, I went to the burial ground and tried to correlate, and I found some menhirs also there. They have used for the burial, and also some stone slabs from here that they have used. Moving on to, we also have found an elephant motif. First, we thought that it can be natural, but later when we cleaned it and these wave-like designs came out, patterns came out. So we understood that it is man-made. They have used hammer and chisel to create this. Dr. Sujit Nayan sir on this said that it is possible that they are trying to show that an elephant is coming out of water, because for the civilization, down the valley there is a river which is very important for the local villagers. We don't know how important it was for the Vangchia archaeological site or the people living here. Another similar motif we find right next to this elephant motif is a fish motif. I have highlighted it to clearly show that a fish kind of structure is seen here. Don't know if they were trying to use it for some natural worship or for what purpose. Further more researches are needed to be done to justify the findings. Moving on to water pavilions. There are 6 major water pavilions that have been found. Apart from that, more water pavilions are still being found at the different places as the exploration is going on. So these water pavilions range from 1.37 meter, which is the smallest that we found, and to 21.5 meter, the longest we were found. These Sujit Nayan sir says that these water pavilions were made for water harvesting. So you can see also before and after image, it is covered in dirt, and when we clean, we found some stones. And these cup marks or the holes are man-made. I'll show it in the next slide. This is the biggest one water pavilion that we have came across. And all these holes are man-made. They are chiseled. We don't know for exactly what purpose they used it, but it is possible that they made this for water harvesting. Here is a perennial stream, which during monsoon looks like a waterfall also. While we started cleaning this area, we came across one more structure, which you can see is on top of the water pavilion. Then what I believe that maybe this structure is for sitting area so that they can enjoy this area as a recreational purpose. For proving my point, I'll show another picture. Just imagine if you're sitting here, if on this water pavilion, and if you'll try to look toward this side, and it's rainy season, and the waterfall is happening from here, you can pretty much enjoy the view. Moving on to the different water pavilion that we found, this was down below the road toward the Menhees. This is also again supported by a retaining wall, and then there's a small water pavilion. From there, if we see, you can see the retaining wall supporting the terrace. Again, this is a very interesting finding. This is a very interesting image. I'll tell why. Because in this one, we see 2 to 3 different phase of the site. It is also possible that water pavilions were made by a totally different civilization, or from the same civilization, or was made in the same phase or in a different phase. Because you'll see that some of the holes are exposed, some are not exposed. On the top of the water pavilion, you'll see a structure is there. I'll show a clear view, a closer view. You can see we stopped cleaning here just to show the difference, the strata of 2 different layers, one with the water pavilion, one where we have exposed the water pavilion, one again the same stone structures with the 2-3 steps and stone slabs was found. Moving on, this is the smallest stone we found with 3 cup marks, part of a water pavilion. The cup marks size are from 19 centimeter to 26 centimeter. There is a brush for the scale size. And this was found while we were exploring towards the quarry site, which is almost 10 kilometer from the original archaeological site of Wangchia, where the stone slabs and water pavilion and menhees are found. Moving on to, we also came across through 4 to 5 caves, which is also was protected by ASI Guwahati Circle earlier. And these caves are man-made. You can see the marks here. They are not natural caves. The local villagers told me that there were huge stone slabs in front of these caves, covering the caves. And when we see the caves are in the map, I would like to show that caves are here at the number 4. And from here, it is at the topmost region of the hill. It's the topmost cliff of the hill. And from there, when you see towards, it's all valley. It is very much possible that a different civilization towards the east side is the Myanmar border. And it is very much possible that a different civilization or different people were living there, or maybe they were guarding themselves or using this cave as watchtowers, and they were guarding themselves from different tribes or enemies or from animals or anything. Moving on to menhees. This is a complex made by ASI Guwahati, and they have protected this site. And now Mizoram has one historical site where people can go and visit and enjoy the history of Mizoram. This is a proper complex, a broader view of the complex of menhees. There are a total and 210 just here. And more menhees were found in and around the village. And as much as we explored in the district, we found more menhees. About the menhees detail, I'll be talking at the end of my slides. I'll be showing few menhees and certain pictographical details on them. No excavation or the burial ground has been found below this menhees. They have been used as a as if they are the museum. These menhees are used as if they are the museum or are as a gallery where they have used stones to display what is happening in the civilization. Pictographical depictions are there. and that I'll be discussing at the end of my slides. Before that, I'll be talking about the great menhir that we found. This is almost 7.2 meter long by 4.72 meter long, and this is the one which we found at the quarry site, where we also find certain small stone slabs being prepared. While going toward the site, one very interesting thing that we found was it was connected from the village, from the menhir complex to till this area through small staircases, which when I counted were around 250 plus, but most of them has been destroyed or are uncovered due to mud or landslides. In this image, you will see that there is a man with a headdress, and then there are several small people standing holding each other's shoulder. Then there is a stone slab or a fine line to distinguish, and then again the similar pattern of small people have been depicted. This, the bigger man is holding a spear, is probably the chief of the tribe or the main hunter of the tribe or the greatest warrior of the tribe. Apart from that, on this whole menhir, we see certain depictions of different animals such as hornbill, mithun, mithun horn, lizard, and even snake. It is not clear in this picture, but I have tried as much as I can show. Moving on, I'll explain that how and where the quarry site is. So this is where the menhir complex is, and from here till here it is somewhere around 10 kilometers, and we traveled on this sedimentary, muddy, loose soil, and it was very risky. I will not suggest anyone to go there without the local villagers. So the phone number are the where we found two watchtowers, and you can clearly see there is a valley. So most probably that these are the watchtowers. They were trying to defend themselves through other tribes. Then from here till number one, we have found small staircases, small steps. And at number three, we found two more menhirs. And number two, we found the smallest water pavilion, which I have shown earlier. Moving on to menhir's image description in relation with present mesoculture and the work. I tried to explain the pictographical depiction of these menhirs. So one very common depiction that we see on these menhirs are multiple people standing together and holding each other's shoulders, which is generally a sign of unity. When we show a community or a unity, we hold each other's hands or shoulder. Then another one is a stacked horn of mithun. Mithun is the common animal, local animal of Mizoram. So another one, this is a stacked horn of mithun, which when I went to the Mizoram State Museum, I found a book there about the tribes, local tribes of Mizoram, and in which I came across this image. And this image depicts and shows the description of this image was that they used this right outside their community or the tribe to show how strong the community is. Basically, the number of heads stacked or the kind of head stack shows the strength of the community, the warrior community. Then another one we see is mithun head on a stick, which another image I took in Mizoram State Museum, and this were used by the warriors or the chief. Right, they used to place this outside their house to show their strength. Moving on, another one is image which I think is probably of a tiger, because there are strips that you can see, and I have used an image that tiger, when they greet each other, they open their mouth and their tails are straight. Another very common depiction that I found was of a bird, a hornbill bird. The depiction is very similar to hornbill bird. The same kind of wings, the legs, and the beak. And the hornbill is the local bird of Mizoram. Another depiction is of a goat. I have given image for that for the reference purpose. Then, the local deers. These deers are swamp deers without antlers, are found in Mizoram. Their depictions are there. Then another one, this one is, I have used a buffalo swimming in water. But if you see this, you can see a head of a Mithun and a straight body. When you see a animal like cow, buffalo, or Mithun floating in water, you will get the similar kind of image. Then we see spears. Then this is a spoon that they use. There's a female hookah pipe. You can see this hookah here, the same kind of depiction. And also there was a genital mark on this image, which I haven't shown here. And that is how I could relate that this is a female hookah pipe. We can also see a necklace depicted on the menhirs. Then you can see here the same. This one is, I think, is the Mithun horn used for the horn used for the mug purpose, for the rice, beer, or wine they used to have, the local tribes used to have. I am relating these images with the what knowledge I got in the tribal, on the State Museum of Mizoram about the tribal people. I'm trying to relate it with what the depiction is on menhirs so that we can understand what the civilization is there. So moving on, this is another view of menhir. You can see again a warrior kind of image. He is holding a pipe or hookah. There are Mithun description here. Then again, small human-like figures. Maybe most probably representing the community or the unity of the community. Necklace and other. There are so many other things that I was not able to decipher yet, which is obviously needs work to be done. Another view of a menhir is here again. You can see a man is made with other small Mithun depictions, necklace, and he's holding a spear. And okay, and this one is a bit interesting one, because here in this one you will see the main guy is also having a sword. It is a huge sword, which is, it's not a one sleek sword that you will use to fight or something. It is a huge sword. Maybe it was used for butchering animals or for war. This kind of depiction of swords we also find in our ancient literature, where they have used it with Rakshasa clans or similar kind of people. Anyways, okay. And rest the same similar kind of depiction is there. There is a hookah, then there is a hornbill, there is a necklace. And I'm sorry that this image is covered with shade, as it was very hard there to get pictures clicked. It's not an easy terrain. Moving on to the conclusion, I would like to say that the site holds a huge potential. More research, more team needs to go there and do more research. This might help reconstruct the Mizoram history, that when we study about Mizoram history, as I earlier said, that all we know is about the post-colonial period, that British went there, and before that it was just tribe, and in around 16th century they migrated from China. But there are two datings of the site. One says around 1400 AD and one says around 680. We are still not clear about the right date for the site. So let's see what will happen. Another point I would like to say that is these people are hunters and warriors. In the Middle East, we have also seen female warriors, which also suggests that the society was a matriarchal society, which still Mizoram is a matriarchal society. It's not a patriarchal society, which defines a society a lot, but changes everything about the society. And showing a female warrior is a great depiction, I believe. And I think I would like to conclude my slide with this last point. And thank you. Anyone has any questions?